What went wrong with the HS2 railway project? After over 15 years of planning, constructing and countless delays, the ambitious vision to connect London to Birmingham and beyond has drastically changed. Today, much of HS2 has been shelved, with about £27 billion sent down the drain. Why is this project struggling? And what does it mean for the future of rail travel in the UK? In this video, we'll explore the reasons behind the skyrocketing costs, the political decisions that complicated its path, and the proposed alternatives that might salvage some of its original goals. Stick around as we unravel the truth behind HS2's troubles, and what could have been done differently to avoid this massive setback. Your understanding of the UK's rail infrastructure and what the future holds starts here. Before we speed ahead with HS2's story, hit subscribe for more videos on the biggest and best infrastructure projects and groundbreaking designs from around the world. The idea for a high-speed railway in the UK didn't appear out of nowhere. Back in the early 1980s, the UK was lagging behind its European neighbours, especially France. France already had the TGV, their super-fast trains zooming across the country. So, it was clear the UK needed something to keep up. This is when they came up with HS2, High Speed 2. The plan was to connect London with the major cities in the north, like Birmingham, Leeds and Manchester, for faster travel, better connections, and to ease the pressure on existing lines. The plan was put into motion in 2009 when the Labour government officially proposed HS2 with the aim to boost the economy and reduce travel times between major cities. As for who handled this behemoth of a project, it was first overseen by a government-owned company called High Speed 2 Limited. They did propose an initial cost back then. And, well, let's just say they underestimated things big time. The shocking thing is that this project started with an estimated cost of £32 billion. But due to uncountable delays and rising inflation, the cost spiralled out of control. By 2023, the budget was around £136 billion. So, who gave the green light to this mega project? Initially, it was a Labour government under Gordon Brown, but the project was carried forward under Conservative governments, with successive Prime Ministers backing it, from David Cameron to Boris Johnson. But it was never an easy project. It was plagued by delays, rising costs, and increasing scepticism about its benefits. So, what are the problems preventing the completion of this high-speed railway line? First off, yes, we can defend the project slightly. Inflation is affecting everything, so the rising costs are not entirely shocking. But even considering inflation, we are looking at a significant overspend. Jumping from £32 billion to £136 billion is just too much. It is nearly three times the original figure. The UK has a serious problem when it comes to building infrastructure efficiently. Take underground tunnelling costs, for example. In the UK, it costs a staggering £676 million per mile, while Spain does it for just £113 million. Even Madrid managed to construct an 81-mile underground line at £61 million per mile, which was nine times cheaper than the Jubilee line extension in London. And when we look over to France, they built their high-speed lines for about £50 million per mile. But the 140 miles between London and Birmingham is set to cost us £356 million per mile. Something is definitely not right here. One reason behind these outrageous costs is the UK's dense population. Land here is expensive, and house prices have gone through the roof since 2010. That's made land acquisition costly, especially compared to countries like Spain or France, which have more open, rural spaces to work with. But there's another issue. You see, HS2 was designed to reach 200 miles per hour, which is an impressive speed, but also an expensive one. Maybe aiming for lower speeds would have saved some serious cash. Over in Spain, the government has kept costs down by using standardized techniques and not going overboard with unnecessary features. The UK could have taken a page from their book. Then there's the political meddling. The route has been altered again and again to avoid upsetting local MPs, especially in areas like the Chilterns. To get from London to Birmingham, the railway had to cut through the Chilterns, which has been labelled as an area of outstanding natural beauty. That's where things started to get complicated. Instead of taking a more straightforward route through existing infrastructure like the M40, they decided to protect the landscape at all costs. Locals were not happy, and influential Tory MPs jumped in to fight for their constituents. As a result, the project was forced to make costly changes, like building a series of tunnels and viaducts to preserve the hills. Now, 11 tunnels stretch for over 32 miles, and 50 viaducts were added along the way, all just to keep the trains hidden from view. This decision to prioritise scenery over practicality threw the budget off track. It was not just a minor tweak. It added billions to the already inflated costs. And the worst part was that it didn't really solve anything. The delays and cost overruns piled up, and the project became more about pleasing a few than delivering a solid infrastructure plan. And then they had to design the ventilation shafts as farmhouses just to blend into the countryside. In other words, the UK is spending millions on optics rather than efficiency. What really made things worse is how stop-start everything has been. Every time there's a pause in construction or a new set of plans, costs rise. Contractors see delays and use it as an opportunity to demand more money. And let's be real, these delays are not exactly making things smoother. They lose skilled workers and the whole project gets more chaotic every time there is a delay. On top of that, there's an overabundance of management. HS2 has been criticised for being too bureaucratic, with too many executives being paid six-figure salaries. For all this management, you would expect things to be running like clockwork. But no, it's the opposite. Finally, the reason for the failure of HS2 is opportunity cost. The UK has sunk billions into HS2, and it's starting to feel like it might never see the value of that investment. There are so many things they could have done with that money. They could have fixed the NHS, improved education, or even built affordable housing. Instead, they are stuck with a half-finished railway that might not even be worth the price tag in the end. After years of delays and rising costs, HS2 finally hit a wall. In October 2023, the then Prime Minister, Rishi Sunak, officially announced that Phase 2 would be scrapped. This phase included the most critical part of the plan, which would have connected London to the north. This meant the railway would include just the least valuable portion of the line between Birmingham and suburban West London. Trains would now stop at Old Oak Common instead of reaching central London's Euston Station, and even that is not guaranteed. After this announcement, an alternative branch was proposed to try and salvage something from the project. Instead of a full-on high-speed line from Birmingham to Manchester, they proposed a slightly slower but cheaper version. This new plan would cover 50 miles and would link up with the Northern Powerhouse rail line near Manchester Airport. The best thing about this alternative plan is that it's going to cost 25% to 40% less than the original HS2 Phase 2 plan. And surprisingly, it might even get some private funding to help cover the costs. But, let's be real, that's not exactly guaranteed. Sure, private investors might help, but only if they're getting something big in return. So, While it sounds like a clever way to cut costs, it is definitely a risky move. On top of that, there is the issue of County Durham, where local leaders are pushing hard for the government to stick to its promise of £72.8 million in reallocated HS2 funds. This cash was part of a £4.7 billion fund aimed at boosting transport across the North East, and County Durham was depending on it for transport upgrades between 2025 and 2027. But, to our surprise, the government has not confirmed if that money is actually coming through. The Deputy Mayor of the North East is furious over this. He called it completely unacceptable if they don't receive the promised funds. And he is not wrong. Without that money, the region's plans for better connectivity are basically toast. In the end, we're just happy to see that this project is going somewhere at last. After constant delays, an alternative plan has saved the day. As per the new plan, the trains will run slower, sure, but only by 15 minutes compared to what HS2 originally promised. Still, it is faster than what we have now by about 30 minutes, so there is that. The alternative plan is trying to make the best out of a bad situation, but the fact that the UK is already talking about cutting costs and scaling back expectations does not exactly inspire confidence. At the end of the day, it is better than nothing, but it's a far cry from the grand vision we were once promised. As it stands, HS2 is expected to be operational, well, at least the London to Birmingham section, by the late 2030s. If everything goes as planned, trains could run at speeds of up to 225 miles per hour, with around 9 to 11 trains per hour. The current section will have a handful of major stations, including Old Oak Common and Birmingham Curzon Street, and it is designed to cut travel time significantly between these two cities. So, with all the delays, changes, and sky-high costs, is this project still exciting? Well, that's for you to decide, but the real question might be, will it even live up to the hype? We are going to find out in the coming months and years. As for now, don't forget to subscribe to our channel for more great videos. Thanks for watching. See you in the next one. Goodbye.